Let's serve our God now with worship as we join in singing hymn number 3. And let's stand.
Serve a mighty God who not only created us but who holds all things in its place. That's why we come before the Lord this morning in worship and praise and thankfulness. Benny and play in his playing and the blessings that we receive from worshiping the Lord. I hope you know so far only one person has taken advantage of. There are prayer cards out there in the hallway. So please fill one out or two and put it in the offering or give it to me after the service, and we will pray. And I mean, we definitely need to be praying for Israel and our country. But right across from where these are is the TV. And I hope everybody looks at the TV and sees all the list of events that we have for October and November coming up, and some of the other events and dealing with Bible study and various things. And it's very informational. So if you haven't, please do that. And there are some books there by the bulletins. Those are from the Radio Bible Class. They come to the church free, and I forget to put them out sometimes, but they're there, they're free. Take one. There's a prayer journal and a number of other good books, especially in dealing with when times of difficulties and things like that happen. So remember that. And remember this Saturday, 10 o'clock, the ladies' Bible study. here at church, in the Sunday school room in the back, ladies, this Saturday at 10 o'clock. And also we need some new teachers, just teachers in general, but if the Lord is leading you, please think about, and in the nursery, we do need some nursery workers also. So if you're thinking about it, please do it. Sign up. And also, on the right side of the bulletin, that is the Psalm 110. That's a messianic psalm. It's a psalm about Jesus. And it is tied to the sermon, but also, when you think about, as I read from Matthew, the book of Hebrews, chapter 5, starting with verse 4 to the end of the chapter, and it's about Melchizedek also, which is because Jesus is our high priest. Zechariah 3 is going to deal somewhat with that. So it's all tied together. Hebrews chapter 5, starting with verse 4. And no man takes this honor to himself, but he who is called by God, just as Aaron was. So also Christ did not glorify himself to become high priest, but it was he who said to him, "You are my son, today I have begotten you." As he also says in another place, and that's Psalm 110, "You are a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek, who in the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and supplications with vehement cries and tears to him, who was able to save him from death, who was heard because of his godly fear, though he was a son, and he learned obedience by the things he suffered. And having been perfected, he became the author of eternal salvation to all who obey him, called by God as a high priest, according to the order of Melchizedek, of whom we have much to say and hard to explain since you have become dull of hearing." He's talking to saints. "For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the first principles of the oracles of God." He's saying you need to start learning over the ABCs, the basics. "And you have come to need milk and not solid food. For everyone who partakes only of milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. But solid food belongs to those who are of full age, that is, those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil." And not only do our churches and our country need this, but boy, in dealing with who Christ is, this is some of those things. And as we go into our time of prayer, I do want us to remember to pray for Israel. Pray for them. That they're the apple of God's eyes. And this is part of his plan, as we will see from Zechariah 3. So keep Israel in prayer. Pray that Hamas can repent. We want to pray for Mr. Kim. Keep Benny in prayer. Sue and Leo. And keep Gail and Jossie and baby Sienna are in Ohio this morning. They'll be traveling back this afternoon. So keep them in prayer for safe travel. So keep them in prayer. We've got a whole list of prayers here. And pray for our country. It is remarkable what I saw Friday on the news. I mean, the young people and people in their 20s and 30s in New York and other places supporting Hamas, holding up their cell phones with the swastika on it and saying Hitler is right. That's in our country. I saw this. I don't see it on 247, and it's remarkable. But this was in New York and other parts of our country, the young people supporting the terrorists. And we are in deep danger. So not only pray for Israel, those names I mentioned, and also our country. Let's bow our heads as we come before our Lord. Almighty God, we come to you by the grace of God, the grace you give to us and because of our Savior Jesus Christ, who made the way, because he is the way, Lord Father. We thank you for that precious way that has opened the door to you, Almighty God. And we do pray, we pray for Israel, Lord Father, for your hand of protection and grace and in your plan and your program that you have for Israel. It is the apple of your eye, Lord Father. We lift them up in prayer. Oh, Lord Father, continue to bless them. Help them to believe in Jesus Christ, the Savior and Lord. Help them to turn to you, who will be, you are their help, Lord Father, and help them to see their need of you. We pray for Mr. Kim. We lift him up in prayer for your healing hand and your hand of grace upon him, along with Benny, Lord Father, your healing hand and hand of strength upon him. Bless the both of them, Lord Father. We pray for our sister Sue and brother Leo and Gail and Jossie and Tiana as they travel for safety of travel, Lord Father. Almighty God, keep them in health and safety and in one piece as they come back to Michigan. And we pray for our country, Lord Father. We pray that you teach our country humility, that it might learn to look to you and not the enemies of the cross, Lord Father. We pray, Lord, that we can humble ourselves, recognize our sin and acknowledge our sin, Lord Father, and turn to Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord, who is the way. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for being that way. And we pray, Lord Father, for every heart here, that our faith will not only be challenged, but our faith will grow in Jesus, that we will see Jesus this morning, who he is, his person and work, and all that he's done, Lord Father. Give us wisdom. In Jesus Christ, we ask these things. Amen.
Let's continue our worship with hymn number 224. Continue now with hymn number 431.
Thank you.
some presents from the shadows into your radiance. By the blood I'm into your brightness. Search me, try me, consume all my darkness. Shine on me. Turn now for our responsive reading to number 381. Let's stand as we join together in reading from God's Word. Wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, Christ Jesus.
For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin.
Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace.
This man, because he continueth ever, hath an unchangeable priesthood.
Wherefore, he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them.
For such an high priest became us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens.
Who needeth not daily, as those high priests, to offer up sacrifice, first for his own sins and then for the people's, for this he did once, when he offered up himself. After he had offered one sacrifice,
sat down on the right hand of God.
For by one offering he hath perfected forever them that are sanctified.
Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood.
for our offering, let's turn, or for our offering, let's turn to 337.
Let us pray. You're thankful to allow us to be here, Lord, praising you hand in hand and heart in heart. And of course, nothing but the blood can help us get to you, Lord.
Yes.
Lord, as we collect this offering, allow me to help your church, Lord, and its people, and help us guide people to you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Greetings to you. In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. What a lovely day. It is the Lord's day. We are going to praise God. A few weeks back, I remember preaching here on the Lord's Prayer. Remember that? The Lord taught us to pray. And He said, you pray like this. We said it's a pattern, right? Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on the earth as it is in heaven. What a beautiful prayer. Lord, let your will be done in my life, right here, as it is done in heaven. So we are going to sing the Lord's Prayer now together. A little complicated song. Just follow along with us. Your kingdom come, Father, let your will be done on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Father, let your kingdom come, Father, let your will be done on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Give us this day a daily bread. Forgive us, we forgive the ones who sin against us. Forgive them, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Let your kingdom come. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done. On earth as in heaven, reign in my heart. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Give us this day a daily bread. Forgive us, as we forgive the ones who sin against us. Forgive them, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Let your kingdom come. It's yours, all yours, the kingdom, the power, the glory are yours. Amen. Oh, it's yours, all yours, forever and ever, the kingdom is yours. Say it again. It's yours, all yours, the kingdom, the power, the glory are yours. It's yours, all yours, forever and ever, the kingdom is yours. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done. On earth as in heaven,
Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Oh, hallelujah. We give you glory and honor. Lord, it's our prayer, O Master God, that, Lord, your will be done as it is in heaven, O Master God, in our own life. Lord, let your kingdom come in every aspect of our life. Let your kingdom come into our hearts, O Master God. And so, O Lord, you rule over us. Lord, let your rule be in our life, O Master, in every aspect of our life. And Lord, let us seek, O Lord, to do your will. Seek to please you in all that we do, O Master. And Lord, seek to love you. And Lord, seek to obey you in everything we do. May your kingdom come upon us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah.
Our pastor comes. Let's turn to hymn number 552, sing verses 1, 2, and 3.
I have heard thy voice.
Open your Bibles to Zechariah chapter 3. And chapter 3 is definitely speaking about Jesus. Oh, there's so much about Jesus in this chapter. It is overwhelming. Overwhelming. Christ provides new clothes. That's what he does for every lost sinner that comes to him. He gives something. In fact, as we go through the sermon, I want you to think, I remember that program Intervention, and this is where Christ is intervening for lost man. Amen. Intervention. Because we need help. I'll be reading the whole chapter. It's 10 verses. And it all speaks of Jesus. Then he showed me Joshua the high priest standing before the angel of the Lord. Remember, the angel of the Lord is the pre-incarnate Jesus Christ. So Jesus Christ is right there. And Satan standing at his right hand opposed to him. Guess who's there? Satan was alive and well in the United States this week. And in Israel. And the Lord said to Satan, "The Lord rebuke you, Satan. The Lord who has chosen Jerusalem rebuke you. Is this not a brand plucked from the fire?" Jude verse 23 quotes him. Now Joshua was clothed with filthy garments. The book of Jude also mentions filthy garments. And he was standing before the angel, talking about the angel of the Lord, Jesus Christ. Then he answered and spoke to those who stood before him, saying, "Take away the filthy garments from him." And to him he said, "See, I have removed your iniquity from you, and I will clothe you with rich robes." And I said, "Let them put a clean turban on his head." Just for you to know that the high priest wore a turban. And on that turban it said, "Holy to the Lord." It was about holiness. That's why we sung a song, a couple, about holiness. So they put a clean turban on his head, and they put the clothes on him, and the angel of the Lord stood by it. Jesus Christ was right there. Then the angel of the Lord admonished Joshua, saying, "Thus saith the Lord of hosts, if you will walk in my ways, and if you will keep my command, then you shall also judge my house, and likewise have charge over of my courts. I will give you places to walk among those who stand here. Hear, O Joshua, the high priest, you and your companions who sit before you, for they are a wondrous sign. For behold, I am bringing forth my servant, the branch." That's Jesus. "For behold, the stone which I have laid before Joshua, upon the stone are seven eyes." That's Jesus. "Behold, I will engrave in its inscription, says the Lord of hosts, and I will remove the iniquity of that land in one day." That's the cross. "And in that day, says the Lord of hosts, everyone will invite his neighbor under his vine and under his fig tree." Now remember, this is the fourth vision God has given to Zechariah. And I put in the outline, and the outlines are important because it will help you hopefully remember not only the Old Testament, but the involvement of Jesus Christ here. Now, the beginning of this, in verse 1, he says, "Then he showed me Joshua the high priest standing there." Remember, in verse 8, he says, "My servant the branch." He's sending my servant the branch. Remember, this is 520 B.C., Jesus ain't coming for another little over 500 years to be born in Bethlehem. So he's still got 500 years. Now think about that. I don't think our country has 500 years. I don't know if our world has 500 years. The rate it's going, 500 years is a long time off. So remember, he's talking to Joshua, the high priest. Joshua, the high priest, was taken into captivity, and he came back with Zerubbabel and some of the others. So as he's come back to the land, and I need to interject this here because this is so important. In the book of Haggai came back in 520. He's rebuilding the temple. The temple will not be finished till 516 BC. Another 4 years. So the Joshua, the high priest, the temple is just starting to be rebuilt. There is no place of worship for them. So what is Joshua, the high priest? He's supposed to go offer sacrifices, but he has no place to sacrifice because it hasn't been built. That's why the focus of this chapter is about Jesus Christ, our high priest, as we will get to this eventually. So Joshua, the high priest, is standing there. As we will see, he has dirty clothes. But God has a plan and program, and it's about taking our sins away through Jesus Christ. That's what is all laid in this chapter, really, in a number of places of the Bible. But notice here, you have Joshua, the high priest, the angel of the Lord, who is Jesus Christ, and you have Satan. Satan is our enemy. He's our adversary. He's our accuser. Sometimes false accuser. But usually he gets it right with me. When I do something wrong, he knows. But in that, Satan is our enemy. He has a hatred for Israel. And that's been displayed in the last 8-9 days, has it not? And even in our own country, it's remarkable the support the terrorists have in our country. Satan is behind that. Satan is alive and well. Not only does he come before the Lord to accuse us, to accuse Israel, but also working in our country, working in our churches, working among especially our youth, is remarkable. Remember, Jesus Christ is the one who pleads the case for the Israelis, for Israel, and he pleads our case for every lost sinner that comes. Jesus is our advocate, 1 John chapter 1. So we have an advocate. We have a lawyer. That's modern. Let me put it in modern day terms. We have a lawyer. Figer can't hold a stick to this guy. But as our advocate, he speaks on our behalf. So as Joshua the high priest is standing before the Lord Jesus, so as he looks at this, as he sees Joshua, as we will see, Joshua has dirty clothes on. So as you read these verses, Jesus rebukes Satan. The Lord rebuke you. The Lord has chosen Jerusalem. God has chosen Jerusalem. Even before the foundations of the world, just like God chose us. That's Ephesians 1, 3, and 4. God chose us before the foundations of the world. And as he chose us, as he chose Israel. And Israel is partly to blame only from the point of their rejection of Jesus Christ. And so I want you to think of 520 BC, then I want you to think of the time of Christ, his birth, and then his death, and then 70 AD when the temple is again destroyed, laid to waste, where there's nothing there but bricks. Brick is the modern day term, apparently. And I want you to think of today, 2023, and I also want you to think about the future, because the book of Revelation is a number of things from the book of Revelation is woven through this because it deals with Jesus. And Jesus is our high priest. I mean, if you had said that to a Jew from in time of Christ or a modern day Jew, they say, no, he can't be a priest. But because of the order of Melchizedek, and God took an oath, God swore that Jesus would be a high priest after the order of Melchizedek, and that's why this is so important. Melchizedek is only mentioned 3 times in the Bible. Genesis 14, Psalm 110, which is on the inside of your bulletin. And then Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14 to chapter 10, verse 18, deals with the superiority of the priesthood, the high priesthood of Jesus over Aaron. There's 6-7 chapters dealt with this issue. So there are three sections of scripture that speak of the high priesthood of Jesus. And this is important because this is part of the plan and program of God. Just like what happened to Israel 7-8 days ago, the start of this. That is in the plan and program of God trying to get their attention. And as God's plan and program is being worked out, remember, still 520 years to Christ to come. That's what's behind us. My servant, the branch, talking about Jesus, the son of Jesse, and dealing with the lineage there. The second thing is, when you look at verse 4 to the latter part of verse 4 and 5, it deals with God gives us clean clothes. When we open our hearts to Jesus Christ, confess our sins, and humble ourselves, and acknowledge our needs, look what he does here, the latter part of verse 4, because this is important, because God wants a kingdom of priests. This is what he had planned all along. The latter part of, let me read verse 4. See, I have removed your iniquity from you, and I will clothe you with rich robes. Remember, Joshua the high priest had dirty clothes. He took them off. You can't serve before God with dirty clothes. Amen. There are people today trying to do that left and right. You can't do it. That's what we'll see in God's ways. Verse 5, then I said, let them put a clean turban on his head. And that turban, holy to the Lord. Holiness literally means to be separated, to be different. We are different than the world. God is totally different than the world. And we are to be like his son. And it is hard at times to be like his son, is it not? Especially when, I cannot speak for you, but I wanted God to smash Hamas instantly this week. But God has a plan and program. So it's not my timetable. It's his timetable and his plan. So, and as you look in the Old Testament to the New Testament, and I put in the outline there, Exodus 19:6, that's where God tells Moses and the Israelites he wants a holy nation, a holy priesthood, a priesthood of people. And he says it in Isaiah 61:6-7, a holy nation to be a nation of priesthood. 1 Peter 2, verses 4 and 5 says the same thing. That stone causes the lost people to stumble, but to us, we're built upon that. It's our foundation stone. There's no doubt in my mind, he's speaking about Jesus, and we'll get into that in a minute. But in 1 Peter chapter 2 and in Revelation chapter 1, verse 6, and really there are more verses, he wants a nation of priests. It's just like we've done this morning and with the youth up here. Plus, Benny, he's a little older. Amen. It's about worshiping God. It's about giving to him because, first of all, we are to be holy. Remember I quoted, he chose us before the foundations of the world to be holy and blameless. Holy, set apart, not for our purposes, but for his purposes, for his glory. And as a nation of priests, referring to Israel, and now today to the church from 1 Peter chapter 2, Revelation, which deals with the future and the past, a kingdom of priests, holy, set apart, so that our worship, and that's going to be the third point, because our worship is important. It's important to God to give to him what rightfully belongs to him, all the praise, the glory, and the honor. And then for ourselves, as we are clean, as Joshua, the high priest, he gets a new turban, clean turban, gets a new robe and everything else. That's what Jesus does for us, gives us a new robe. So we are clean, we are holy, we are righteous. So when you do come to verses 6 and 7, look at verses 6 and 7. Then the angel of the Lord, that's Jesus, remember? I do want to pound that into your mind and hearts. When you see the angel of the Lord in Scripture, that's the pre-incarnate Jesus Christ. So you see Jesus. admonished Joshua, saying, "Thus says the Lord of hosts." Now he's got Joshua's attention. Joshua is ready for worship. That's why we as Christians, when we come to church, you already need to be ready. You do not come to church and get ready right then and there, because if you come dirty, you stay dirty. Only by the blood of Christ, in dealing with our salvation, first of all, but also for the forgiveness of sins. Look what the angel of the Lord says to him. He says, "If you will walk in my ways." He's talking about Jesus. Remember what Jesus said in John 14:6? "I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. No man can come to the Father but by me." And remember when we were in Leviticus a little long time, not that long ago, but the whole thing was about the plan of God and salvation, so that we have access through the brazen altar, the laver, and then the holy place and the holy of holies. It's about having access to God through the high priest. Now it's opened up to all of us because Jesus is our high priest. And this is what is so important to us. That's why worship should be so important to us. In his ways, Jesus is the only way. Hamas needs to learn that. Muslims need to learn that. Any false teacher needs to learn that. His way is Jesus Christ. And that's what he's being so profound here. Then look what he says. "If you will walk in my ways," and that is the way of Jesus Christ. He said, "if you will keep my command." In dealing with the service. That's how you, in dealing with the service of God, his servant. About worship, that's what we came to do this morning, worship. We can evangelize at other times. We can even do it Sunday morning, possibly. But worship, praying, and a whole list of other things in dealing with the service. What the priest, and then what eventually the high priest. Remember, when the high priest went into sacrifice on the Day of Atonement, he had to sacrifice for himself because he was a sinner. Then he sacrificed for the whole nation. Just think, Jesus' death on the cross, his death was for the whole world. For the whole world. That's how awesome this is. And his ways, his service, notice what he says here. "Then you shall also judge my house, the house of the Lord." We come in, this is the Lord's house. We've come to worship him, we've come to praise him, we had taken an offering up to give to him for a number of things, but also to worship him and to praise him and to learn of him. You are learning about Jesus Christ this morning. Amen. As high priest. I bet there's a lot of Christians that, even supposedly Christians, never heard of Melchizedek. And there are a lot of Christians that are confused about Melchizedek because they're babies in Christ. It's important. It is very important what you think about Christ. Have you ever thought about this? If you are wrong about Jesus Christ, it doesn't matter. If you're wrong about Jesus Christ, it doesn't matter what you're right about. You know that? That means everything else is wrong without Jesus. And as Jesus is our high priest, he's made the way. That's why I always had that diagram of the tabernacle, the various things, and you can see the way to the Lord is through Jesus Christ. That is what is being presented here in Zechariah 3. It's about Jesus Christ showing the way. So in his house, remember, this is his house. We worship him in his house, his ways, his service. Not what you choose to do and when you choose to do it. People, I hear all kind of stuff. People make stuff up all the time. And they come to the wrong person. I'm talking about me, because one thing I will do is I will quote scripture to them. And that's where you heard I've gotten in trouble for quoting scripture. I will quote, that's not what scripture says. And I'm talking about church people. People have been church 30, 35, 40 years. Service of the Lord, wasting their time and their lives because they've done it their way. God says, if you're going to serve me, you're going to do it my way. That's through Jesus. You're going to do it my house. Very clear. And then likewise, have charge of my courts. his courts. That's when you look at Revelation chapter 4 and 5 of the book of Revelation, there's nothing but praise and glory there. And remember, looking to the future today and looking in the past, the time in the tabernacle. And remember, that's what Haggai is rebuilding. He came to rebuild the temple. Zechariah is trying to get the people ready to worship so that the temple gets done. Guess what? Joshua the high priest doesn't have a job right now because there's no temple. But there's one being built. So when you come to the time of Christ, he is the temple, as we will see. That's what gets so important here. And that's why, as you look at this, as we get to verse 8 here, he says, my servant, the branch. And what happens is, chapter 6, verse 12, look at another verse in the book of Zechariah. We'll be coming to this in a few weeks. But chapter 6, verse 12 says, behold, the man whose name is the branch. He's talking about Jesus. Jesus is our high priest. He's a number of things here. But as you look at this, this is under God's plan and program. Back, he's talking here, O Joshua the high priest, you and your companions who sit before you, for they are a wondrous sign. Behold, I am bringing forth. Hasn't happened yet. Jesus is going to come. Our time, guess what? He's already come. He came 2,000 years ago. So as we celebrate, and the older we live, we have great expectation of him coming pretty soon, because this is, as we look at our world and our country. And in Psalm 110, verse 4, he mentions there that you are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. The priest died, their priesthood was gone. The high priest, when he died, their priesthood was gone. Jesus lives forever. Guess where our high priest sits? He sits in heaven. He sits on the throne. And guess what? He has the ear of the Father. But he also, we can get his ear when we confess our sins. But even more important than that, praising him, glorifying him, giving the praise and the thanks. And as you look at this, he calls him my servant, the branch. In Philippians chapter 2, when those first 8 verses of Philippians chapter 2, he says he humbled himself, took the form of a man, a servant. He's talking about Jesus here. He is a servant. And as he humbled himself, he did the Father's will. That's what God expects of us as his people, to do his will. And then he says there in verse 9, for I have laid... Behold, the stone that I have laid before Joshua. There is a stone here. And there is no doubt in my mind, this is the stone from Daniel chapter 2 that crushes that statue of the four empires. And that includes Hamas, Hezbollah, ISIS, all of them. You put Iran in there too. Going to be crushed by the stone. And that stone is Jesus Christ. So as you see this picture here is, that I've laid before Joshua, upon the stone are 7 eyes. And in the book of Revelation there, as I put down there, there's just 7 eyes. It deals with wisdom and knowledge, and Jesus knows everything. Amen. This is the plan and program of God. And he says, behold, I will engrave an its inscription, says the Lord of hosts, that I will remove the iniquity of that land in one day. Remember when Jesus died on the cross, then remember what was in the temple? The veil. It was very thick. Human hands couldn't do this. It was torn from top to bottom because God did it. And the tearing of the veil in the temple, no longer the temple isn't needed because our bodies become the temple of God. And that's what Jesus was preaching, and that's what the other apostles and saints taught that are in the New Testament. Our body is the temple of God. The veil has been torn. We all have access, and it's only by Jesus Christ. Who is that rock? He's that rock with 7 eyes. And from the book of Daniel, the book of Haggai and Zechariah, to the time of Christ and his birth. Remember the wise men? Where is the king of the Jews? He was king before he was born. He was king at his birth and king while he lived on earth. That's what they put over his title, King of Kings, on the cross. He died king, he rose king, went to heaven as king. He's on the throne. And guess what? He's coming back as king. But he's also high priest. And I want you to think about this. In Psalm 110, what is so important about that, David wrote that psalm. It's very prophetic. He was talking about a coming king. But that coming king, he was talking about Jesus, the Messiah. But also that coming king would be a high priest. Not mentioned too often in the whole Bible, only three spots. That's why this is so important, of getting this correct. Set in your heart and mind that Jesus is our high priest. We have access because of him. He removes it in one day, and that is his death on the cross. That's why there'll never be another covenant. There'll never be another second new covenant. People say all kinds of things, but it's finished. It's done. Jesus saw to it. And then verse 10, and in that day, says the Lord of hosts, everyone will invite his neighbor under his vine and under his fig tree. That's why, whether it's for the Jew in Israel, you can say Hamas, you can say for any evil person, for any lost person, it's Jesus Christ can take their sins away. Just think, Hamas can be forgiven. That would be awesome. Powerful. Gracious. That's the way our God is. And that's what's sitting here in Zechariah chapter 3. The branch. Notice it says here, the branch is my servant, the branch. Chapter 6, verse 12. He talks about, and that corresponds to the gospel of Mark. Mark is the gospel of servanthood. The word immediately is the key word in the Gospel of Mark, because that's what a servant does. Master tells him, he goes and does it immediately. In Zechariah 6:12, it talks about the branch, the man who's the branch. That's the Gospel of Luke. The Gospel of Luke is about the humanity of Jesus Christ. How God planned all this out. Jeremiah 23, verse 5, it says, I will raise to David a branch. Talking about the king. That's the Gospel of Matthew. And then the Gospel of John in Isaiah 4, 2, it says, I will raise the branch of the Lord, the branch of Jehovah, the branch of God. The Gospel of John is a picture of Jesus Christ as God. Wow. You see, this is all planned and programmed. Each gospel serves to preach Jesus Christ as king, as servant, as man, in his humanity, and as God. And the world today definitely has a hard problem. They don't mind saying he was a man or prophet who did good things. But when you say Jesus is God, that's where it stops for the world. But this speaks of him. And remember, this is 500 years before he was born. This is God's plan and part of God's program. And it's tied to the rock in Daniel and the statue in Daniel chapter 2. And Jesus is going to smash. I kind of want Jesus to smash Hamas right now, but it's not my will, but because he has a plan and purpose. And it's going to unfold in history. When Jesus comes back, don't know. Don't know. But I'm going to close with reading, before we sing a song, Hebrews chapter 7, verses 23 and 25 to 25. He says, also there were many priests because they were prevented by death from continuing. But he, it's in capital letters, referring to Jesus, because he continues forever as an unchangeable priesthood. high priest. Therefore, he is also able to save to the utmost. Just say, he can save the people who are Hamas, Hezbollah, ISIS. Put any other names in there. He can save them. Who come to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. For such a high priest was fitting for us, who is holy, blameless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and has become higher than the heavens, who does not need daily, as those high priests, to offer up sacrifices, first for his own sins and then for the people's. For this he did once and for all when he offered himself up. That's why Zechariah speaks of that. In one day I will take your sins away. I mean, there are so many pictures of Jesus in Zechariah chapter 3. He just blossoms forth. And so as we as Christians, as we study and learn, we say, wow, the scriptures do speak of Jesus, the Old Testament. That's why we need to learn the Old Testament, read the Old Testament, so that we can learn more about Jesus, and especially his high priesthood. Not much is said about that, but he is our high priest. God accepted him, and he's on the throne. You know, our high priest is in heaven on the throne. He's our king. He's our prophet. Praise the Lord. Number 580, as we stand and close this morning, only trust him. That's what Jesus wants. He wants us to trust him. Number 580, verse 2. And I will need everybody singing because I need a lot of help. 480, excuse me. Number 480, only trust him. Verse 2. Shed his precious blood, which blessings to bestow. Plunge now into the crimson flood that washes white as snow. Only trust him, only trust him, only trust him. Let's bow our heads. Oh, mighty God, we plead the precious blood of Jesus Christ this morning, our Lord, our Savior, our God, our High Priest, Lord. As you intercede for us, as Satan is right there accusing us, oh, mighty God, you stand ready to declare your righteousness because we believe by faith the blood of Jesus Christ has taken away our sins and given us his righteousness. Oh, mighty God, what an awesome day. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for the high priesthood of Jesus, our God and Lord. Bless our hearts, Lord Father. Stir our hearts that we will not only pray for this lost world, but we will, Lord Father, be a living testimony to the grace that he's given to us. The forgiveness of our sins. In Jesus Christ, we ask these things. Amen.